now have Anshu Gupta, founder director of Goonj, and also an Ashok fellow. Anshu founded Goonj in 1998, an organization which recycles anything, including the bag that you have been given, that is discarded as an urban waste into a resource for others in the rural and calamity hit areas. Goonj collects about 50,000 kgs every month across India and turns them into something usable for the very poor. Clothing, bags, sanitary napkins, etc. and reaches them to the needy across 20 states through a network of more than 100 grassroots NGOs. Anshu Gupta is an alumnus of the Indian Institute of Mass Communications and Master in Economics. Anshu Gupta is an Ashok Fellow, as you know, Ashok Global Ambassador. For his work, he has been the recipient of Changemakers Innovation Award 2004-2006, World Bank Development Marketplace Award 2007, NGO of the Year Award 2007. I present to you Anshu Gupta.
Hi, good afternoon. I have 15 minutes, and how many of you have already heard the story of clothing? So many of you have already heard, so maybe I'll try to skip that part today. Because my role to come here basically is to be honest, make you angry or to bring out your anger. In a nutshell, to start with, we work on a very basic issue of clothing for the people who don't know about it. And the whole idea is to bring it in the list of development subjects, because say about 12 years back we started arguing that you talk about three basic needs, you say food, cloth and shelter, and then you suddenly ignore the clothing part. Clothing, you only consider a disaster, relief material. In a country, in a world where half the world does not need a disaster, it's already in that state. So you actually need a flood or earthquake to receive clothes for yourself. In a country, especially where more people die in winters than earthquake or flood. And please remember, earthquake kills people, flood kills people, accident kills people, winters don't kill people. The low temperature does not kill people, because in the same temperature, if I survive and someone else dies, it's the lack of clothing which kills people. So about 12 years back, we started working on that. Typical mindset we wanted to change. The fact also remains that although you talk about three basic needs, you say roti kapda makan, but in the list of development subject, you will never find a mention of clothing as a subject. The same list has some 150 subjects from domestic violence to global warming, but a basic need is not included there. So we started working on that. Very simple thing, we said that in urban parts, whenever you say that I want to donate cloth, that's a wrong statement, overstatement, because you actually never donate, you discard. So the person who wears your second-hand used cloth is doing a service to you. So please, let's correct yourself. On the other part, in rural parts, we say that the biggest asset of rural India or rural areas across the globe is something called self-respect. Beggars are found only and only in the cities. Begging is a typical city phenomenon. So let us not challenge their dignity. So the initiative is called Cloth for Work, where people do a whole lot of community work and then receive material as reward, as wages. That's how it is. It's growing more of a, as one of those non-monetary resource agencies than an NGO or social enterprise, whatever you want to call it. Larger issue was certainly sanitary pad, where we noticed that there is no mention about it a few years back. And in this particular country, women actually share the same piece of cloth. We have cases where, like a lady used a piece of blouse, which had a hope she died of tetanus. Then we found a village where in the group of 18 to 40, a large number of women didn't have uterus because it was removed just because the napkin was not there. Then we found that millions of women actually use sand ash, jute gani bag, dari ka tukda, bori ka tukda, newspaper, anything and everything in the name of napkin. So we produced that 100% related to the issue of clothing. Largely growing as a movement, and the entire credit actually goes to the people who are there as volunteers, a very, very large amount of passionate youth. That's how we see the success, that's how we want the replication, that's how we want to grow. Till 12 years back, I had no exposure of rural India, I had no exposure of poverty. I didn't know anything about the country, to be honest. Like a typical corporate job, my eyes were closed. I was not getting angry, I was not showing my anger to anybody. It was a very simple, decent life. Because I, like millions of people in this country, had also accepted status quo. I forgot my basic rights. Like a whole lot of people, I was absolutely ready to pay toll tax on every single road which is black. I never questioned that why do I pay tax on this? This is my basic right. I am just here to ask a few questions from all of you and from myself and from all of us. I want to know a country except UK where a private school is called a public school. This country calls private school a public school. I want to ask you that how many water bills have you ever seen where you found it mentioned that this water is only meant for taking bath or washing clothes? Have you ever seen? Why do we buy water to drink? And the water which comes in the tap is used for washing toilet, washing utensil, or having a bath. Why don't we question? If a mosquito bites us in this country, what is our whistle? The immediate solution is a good night? Or equivalent? What is the largest whistle? Is something called hit, so that I can kill all the mosquitoes in the house. Have we ever questioned why mosquitoes? If there is a news of Tinu Joshi making 360 crore rupees as bribe or whatever in Madhya Pradesh, have you ever thought that how many people must have made 36,000 crore rupees? Because always only a part of your profits you pass on as bribe. So what he was saying is absolutely correct. What we need to understand that in the entire act of bribe, in the entire act of giving, giving comes first, taking comes later. Unfortunately, it is a country of highly self-centered people. We are only worried about ourselves. We do not challenge the status quo. If we get angry, the best way to present that anger is to send an SMS to a friend. That friend send SMS in bulk, the mobile company becomes richer. The problem still remains same. If you have time, you really want to show anger, you will write a mail. It will go to mass mailing. It might become a spam, nothing changes. Just remember Mumbai a couple of years back. Don't you think that the same government is back? Similar kind of people have got same kind of protection, whether it is SPT, RPT, whatever. Everybody got the same protection. What the common citizen of this country did. Every November you go to Gateway of India, burn about 1000 kg of wax, come back singing some Deshbhakti song. Do you think it will solve the problem? Do you think it will solve the problem? In the entire race, if the country remains there, where it was, and we grow, do you think it's a growth? Have you ever seen, or have you ever understood, or have you ever noticed a capital of a country where the local bus has killed 2,000 people in the last few years? Have you ever heard about it? Your capital kills that. And the blue line or the red line still runs on the road. You are actually staying in a country. Let's understand the darker part of it, because we all know the bright part of it. because we are so used to traveling to the international airports, national airports everywhere. But just think about it, that you go to an international airport, you go to the toilet, you don't know how to flush it. But 90% of the Indian railway stations still don't have a usable toilet. 100% of the Indian bus stations don't have a usable toilet. 70% of the population is still there in the villages. 50% of Indian population do not get 2 meals a day. They eat rats, they drink water, they dig a pit in the winters to sleep because they don't have a woolen. And we say we are progressing. I think now the time has come, especially for the youth of this country, that you act. You certainly do not need any kind of debate. There should not be any either or in this country, because you need to understand that we are in a country of volume. The problems are in volume, the solutions needed need to be in volume, the people who work on those solutions need to be in volume. So why do we talk about this either or? Why do we talk about the social enterprise versus business enterprise, social work, charity, donation? Why? Why don't we just talk about that? Why don't we say that this approach is working? Let's just work on it. Why not? And why do we really, really have to innovate on a daily basis? Why? There's no need. I mean, this country does not need thinkers anymore, to be honest. Enough of thinkers. What you need right now is action. And it's a very simple thing. The moment you add an action with a thought, it's an initiative. And that's what is needed. To the youth, one thing which we need to understand, that my father's generation was quite frustrated on a whole lot of conditions in this country. They couldn't do anything. You know why? Because for them, it was a struggle to survive. They wanted their children to study. They wanted a small two-bedroom house somewhere so that the landlord does not tell them again and again to go out. This generation, our generation, your generation, that does not struggle to survive, we struggle to grow. Tell me if I'm wrong. The basic food is taken care of, the basic housing is taken care of. Our role, our struggle is to grow. And in the race of growth, in the struggle of growth, if we personally keep growing and the country does not grow, does not grow. I am here for the next 2 days. We'll talk a lot about Goonj and other issues. Thank you very much. Thank you.